So greetings, students. So we'll be moving towards today's lecture. And in today's lecture, we'll be moving towards the single machine infinite bus system. So we have already dealt with the various parameters that are affecting our power system stability, followed by the primary one is your frequency, and then your rotor angle, and then finally it is about your voltage. So these parameters are the things that are affecting your power system stability. And now we will be moving towards your single machine infinite bus system. Okay. Yeah, I have given a little short brief about the single machine infinite bus system. So we can take over here, the generating source is a single point of source. For example, we can take a thermal power plant. So that thermal power plant is having a synchronous generator, and that synchronous generator is a particular point of source. And from there, it gets stepped out, stepped down to various, it will be directly given to a substations, which has load dispatch centers. And from there, it will be distributed to various other places. And here you can see the source will be a single point, but it gets branches out from that single point to various buses. And so this is called as a single machine and infinite bus system. But between this single machine and the infinite bus, there exist some elements. For example, you will be integrated with the transformer, and this transformer has the ability to step up or step down your voltage. And after that transformer, you'll be connected towards your substation through your various transmission line. And these X1 and X2 corresponds to the transmission lines. Okay, the reactances of your transmission lines. Okay, so this is a actual representation of your single machine infinite bus system. Okay, and now moving on, the particular bus system is represented in an equivalent circuit format. You already know that, right? For each and every parameter in the power system, there arise some equivalent representation. And using that equivalent representation, you will be representing in an equivalent circuit. And this generator is represented as an equivalent circuit in this fashion. And then your transformer is represented in the equivalent representation in this XTR, and then X1 and X2. And finally, your infinite bus is represented in this fashion. So here, the voltage rise will be occurring at this point. At this point of view, the voltage rise occurs. And at this point of view, the voltage drop occurs. So here rise will be your infinite bus. And here will be the single point of source. Okay. And the angle between this bus and then the single point of source will be your del. Okay. So moving on to the power equation. We have already seen about this power equation in the previous lecture. Before getting into the power equation, you will be reducing that particular equivalent circuit. You can reduce this particular equivalent circuit. Okay. Because you're having one point of source and another one point of consumption. Okay. That is your consumer side. And in between that, there exists only your impedance. And this impedance can be represented in an equivalent effective impedance as XT. It's represented as XT. And the power flow from your source towards your load side is represented by your PE. It's represented by your PE. And this PE, you know that, this PE can be written as the sending side voltage into your receiving side voltage divided by the effective impedance XT into sine into del. So we have seen about this derivation in the previous lecture. You can just refer to that if you want to get a clear idea about it again. And the maximum of this power delivery is possible when this sin del is at maximum, because this E dash and EB by XT is a constant. The only variable out here is your power angle del. This power angle del is the only variable, and the sine of this varies with respect to your del value. So in order to get a maximum power delivery, you must have the power angle to be del to be at 90 degrees, and hence you'll be getting the maximum power delivery as E dash, that is the sending end voltage and the receiving end voltage, divided by your XT. So coming to the swing equation, so this is your power angle curve. This is your power angle curve. And here you can see you are taking the power angle at the infinite bus. If you are taking at any two points, if you are taking based upon that, it is taken as A and B. The power angle will be A and B for that particular two bus. So, but it can be connected to any number of buses. Here in this diagram, we have considered only two bus. So this is the power angle curve corresponding to a particular two bus, and based upon that, the maximum has to be arriving at your 90 degrees. But what happens is that the maximum at 90 degrees is a theoretical value only, but it is not a practical possibility. Okay, that because in between that I said right, in between the representation of your XT, in between this XT, that is the effective reactance. So at over here itself, there will be some losses, because that XT covers the impedances of both your transformer as well as your transmission line. Okay, so in between itself, you'll be exposed to some numerous losses in a practical situation. I'm telling about practical situation, not the ideal or theoretical part. Okay, and hence there will be a maximum power delivery, but with a little drop, the little drop for achieving your maximum power. Okay. So here, when unbalance between the torques acting on the rotor occurs, okay, this is with the power angle, and next we'll be moving to a swing equation. So it is a very, very important question in your exam point of view. So you have to know about the swing equation. So there's a possibility of a problem also, but mostly they will be concentrating towards the derivation part. They will be asking derivation from this swing equation. Okay, so what is the swing equation? You have to know. So as you know, for the single point of source, so I have said right, this is your single point of source, and for the single point of source, if you are having mains, the rotor will be having some apart from having some electrical characteristics, it also has mechanical characteristics, that is your torque. Okay, that is your torque. Actually, your torque is formula, you know that torque is equal to electrical power divided by your angular frequency. Okay, that is your T equal to P divided by omega. This formula you have studied in your
Mission 1 and 2,
you might have studied. That is mainly particularly with respect to your synchronous
load characteristics. Load characteristics we will do,
sir. Load characteristics and synchronous generator. There you might have studied. So the thing is, this relates to the rise in the parameter of your torque. Okay, that is your torque relation also comes into the picture. Okay, what happens when there's some kind of, we have seen three parameter, right? Three parameter like frequency, rotor angle, stability, and then the voltage. So what happens with the power delivery when the variation in those three parameters will be directly affecting the torque over the rotor. Okay, so each and everything is interdependent. Each and everything is interdependent. So if any abnormality occurs, in case in any kind of industries, so the the electric board will be directly penalizing that industry. Okay, they'll be directly penalizing the industry because any abnormality causing will affect the entire power system network. So they'll be having a keen watch over the power system network through your SCADA network. Okay, you might have known about SCADA. So that SCADA will be directly giving you information about the power delivery, voltage, even it will be giving out the angle, the phasor angles at which they are being operated. Okay, so if possible, you can see the about SCADA operation in YouTube. Okay, okay, coming to the point, to the swing equation, and the swing equation mainly depends upon your torque. Okay, how the variation with respect to the torque and moment of inertia and the electrical character dependency. Okay, that only determines your swing equation. So here we'll be taking an unbalanced condition. So as I said, as your torque is directly proportional to your power delivery, and yet this power delivery depends upon your frequency and then your rotor angle and then your voltage. Okay, any change in over that will be affecting your torque. Okay, so we can consider the condition that there has been some changes in the frequency, and then it has been affected your power, and then it affected the torque acting on the rotor. Okay, after that, what happens? You have to find the net torque causing the acceleration or deceleration. There can rise two cases wherein the effective torque will be either accelerating or decelerating. Okay, based upon that, your speed of rotation of the rotor also depending. Okay, if it is an acceleration torque, it is well and good. But if it is a deceleration torque, what happens means it directly affects your rotor speed. After I am speaking here about the rotor speed of the synchronous generator, that is the single point of source over here. Okay, that only I am speaking. And here, given the formula, the acceleration torque is equal to the mechanical torque minus your electromagnetic torque. Okay, if this TA is in positive, then it is accelerating. At the same time, if this TA is in negative, then it is decelerating. Okay, so TM corresponds to the mechanical torque and TE corresponds to your electromagnetic torque. So this TM and TE will be positive for your generator. TM and TE will be positive for your generator, and this TM and TE will be negative for your motor. Will be negative for your motor. Okay. So this is the basic starting equation for the swing equation derivation. And after that, what they're saying is that combined inertia of generator and prime mover is accelerated by unbalanced in applied torque. So what they are saying is they are making the inertia combination. So for example, you can see generally in the thermal power plant, what happens is that they will be heating the coal in the boiler. They'll be heating the coal in the boiler. Okay. This coal will be generating the heat, and this heat is responsible for moving your turbines. It is responsible for moving your turbines. Yet this shaft of the turbine will be directly coupled with your, synchronous generator. Okay, will be directly coupled with the synchronous generator, and this particular setup from your turbine to the coupling of your generator is called as your prime mover. Okay. So what you have to consider is, you have to consider the torque of the combined generator as well as your prime mover. This prime mover coupling will be directly coupled towards your rotor, and that rotor on cutting of your electromagnetic flux induced by your stator will be causing the EMF, which is responsible for the power generation. Okay, so this is how the power generation occurs. Okay, and here what they are also asking to consider is, they are asking to consider the mechanical parameters also. So you have to consider the combined inertia of the generator and the prime mover also, you have to take into account. So coming to here, so this J is the parameter which represents the combined moment of inertia of both your generator and the prime mover or the turbine. Both are the same. Prime mover or the turbine are the same. So here the unit is kilogram meter square. And omega m corresponds to the angular velocity of the rotor, which is represented in mechanical radian per second. And t corresponds to the time at a particular instant. So here the acceleration we are representing in terms of the inertia and then your angular velocity. So this is a basic physics formula that you might have come across. Okay, for angular acceleration, it's nothing but moment of inertia into your angular velocity that you already know. The same basic formula is represented over here. And at the other part, what you have seen, it is equal to the mechanical torque minus the electromagnetic torque. Okay, so Tm minus Te. And we are representing this equation in terms of per unit. So you know, right, per unit we have seen, right, as we are coming towards the power system, it is necessary to represent everything in the per unit for easier calculation. Okay, that I have told you in the previous lectures and unit. Okay, and here we are representing it in the per unit, and for that we'll be introducing the constant H. And what is this H means? So it is nothing but a kinetic energy. It is nothing but a kinetic energy in watts per second at rated speed divided by the base power. Okay, so at rated speed divided by your base power. So this is your base power and this corresponds to your rated speed. Okay, and this is a constant. This will be a constant, not a variable. And based upon the maximum rated speed. So here you can see there's a knot. Okay, knot represents nothing but the maximum speed. Divided by the base speed over here they are given. So not maximum, initial angular velocity divided by the base speed. So there will be a threshold speed at which the particular turbine will be starting to rotate. So that initial speed is only omega naught m square. So rated speed will be coming afterwards. I'll be telling you. So here we are representing the J in terms of H. That is keeping the J at one side and bringing other parameters to other side. Okay, so you'll be getting J equal to 2H by omega naught m square VA base. Okay, so after getting the value of J, you have to substitute in this equation. You have to substitute in this equation for the value of J. So you'll be getting, this we have just putting out here, we'll be getting 2H by omega naught m square VA base d omega m by dt Tm minus Te. And you have to rearrange by keeping your H and omega at one side and other parameters at the other side. So 2H d by dt omega m by omega naught m square is equal to Tm minus Te by VA base. Okay. I hope you got some idea. So that is you're rearranging, just rearranging the values, keeping your H and your omega M at one side. And now coming to the initial stage, that is, you know that the base torque. So already I have said that your torque is nothing but the power divided by your omega. So similarly, the base torque at the rotor, T base, is equal to the power VB base divided by the initial speed. Initial speed, okay, rotor speed. And this corresponds to your T base value. Okay. So this derivation might be somewhat confusing, but if you're moving in a step-by-step fashion, it will be easy for you. Okay, first you are finding out the J, and after finding out the J, you are just substituting it in the acceleration equation, torque acceleration equation, and then you will be rearranging. And after that, you will be representing that equation. So here, this omega m by omega naught m square is there, right? So that you will be considering to be omega m by omega naught m. Okay. So here, this T base, VA base by omega naught m is there, right? So here it is VA base. And here there's omega m. So this omega m, one of the omega naught m will be moving towards here, and that becomes a T base. Okay. And after this, your omega r equal to omega m, that is the particular angular velocity of the rotor, divided by the initial speed. Okay. And this also you can just make this to be omega r by PF. So this PF represents the number of poles. Okay. You are just making for simplicity. Okay, here the omega r represents your angular velocity. Omega naught represents the related value, and PF represents the number of field poles. Okay, so I'll be directly getting into the PPT what I have been referring. So the same PPT, which is the Google Classroom only, I'm just referring. Okay, so after this, there are still some more steps. So, okay. So we have rearranged, and then we have got the base power. Okay. So this is the value of your omega r vector. Okay. So it is omega r by omega naught. So after that, what they have given is they are just representing your del. If del is the angular position of the rotor in electrical radians, and then del naught is the initial value at time period t. So at first we have, so it might be somewhat difficult to understand for you. You just have to be clear that up to this rearranging, it is very easy. So after that, what you will be doing is you have to define this omega r. You have to define this omega r, and then you have to define this del value. That is your power angle. So this power angle depends upon the value of the angular velocity of the rotor, omega r t, minus your rated value omega naught t plus your del naught. So this del naught is nothing but the power angle at a particular initial condition t equal to zero. At t equal to zero. And for this particular equation, you will be taking the time derivative d tau by dt, and then the t value gets out, and then you'll be getting omega r minus omega naught. This will be considering to be del omega r. Okay. Okay, I'll be stopping with this. Okay, I think it will be somewhat difficult to follow you for after this. I'll be stopping with this, and the next class again I'll be giving you the brief up of this swing equation again from the beginning, and then I'll be continuing it, and I'll be finishing in the next class. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so. It will be somewhat difficult for you, because after this, this omega r and del, there's some derivatives calculation is there. So I'll be explaining in the jam board. So it will be somewhat easy for you. So I think